Our God has hands, and He wants it to touch our lives. This may turn into a series of sermons. We'll see what happens next Sunday. You will know the answer to that. Let's start with a couple of verses. Famous prayer from 1 Chronicles chapter 4, the prayer of Jabez. Jabez cried out to the God of Israel, "Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me and keep me from harm, so that I will be free from pain." And God granted his request. Habakkuk. Depending on how you grew up, same. Chapter 3, verse 4. His splendor was like the sunrise. Rays flashed from his hand where his power was hidden. So, over the years, I have heard quite a few sermons about seeking the face of God. And they were excellent sermons. I've preached many of them myself. I was recently revisiting some other scriptures in the Bible that talk about the hand of God. Seeking the face of God conveys the idea of seeking God just for his presence, to be with him, to become intimate with him. And that is a good and glorious thing, and we need to do that. Seeking the hand of God conveys the idea of seeking the power of God to meet a need that we have in our life through the supernatural divine intervention of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And so I don't remember the exact year or who it was that I first heard kind of compare these two ideas to one another, but I do remember being pretty blown away the first time I heard a pastor preach on the difference between, you know, people that seek the face of God and people that seek the hand of God. And I remember thinking to myself, oh man, I've been doing this thing all wrong my whole life. I've just been going about this the wrong way. I've been seeking God's hand when I should have been seeking God's face. And so now I'm a little bit older than I was 10 minutes ago and 20 years ago. So there's something that I've seen in the church, and I think that it needs to be fixed. It seems like we as church people have a tendency to think that it either has to be one or the other. Like we can only pick one of the two options. And I'll give you some examples of where I see this a lot in the church. In the church, when you make friends with people, you'll find that you meet people that are grace people and you'll meet people that are works people, right? You either have to be a grace person or a works person. People that pick grace, and they do that, and then they never get busy doing anything in the kingdom of God because, after all, it's all by grace, right? Not by works. So they don't get busy working for the kingdom of God. And then there's people that pick works, and they get so busy working for the kingdom of God that they don't have any time to develop an intimate relationship with Jesus, and then they end up getting burned out. Another example is kind of this thing where you see people that focus on the love of God or people that focus on the holiness of God. You either have to be into the love of God or you have to be into the holiness of God. And people that choose love, they do that. And the next thing you know, we're patting people on the back and we're making excuses for lifestyle choices that they're making that don't line up with what the Word of God says because we're so fixated on the love of God. And then you have people that choose the holiness of God. And the next thing you know, you're just being judged for everything, criticized for everything. No one is doing anything good enough. No one is doing anything right. No one's going to heaven because no one's holy enough. And then you have this thing where people are into seeking the face of God or they're into seeking the hand of God. People choose the face of God. And they develop an intimate relationship with their Savior, but they are left wondering why they're not seeing things happen in their lives like the apostles saw things happen in their lives in the first century church. And people that choose the hand of God, they start to see God moving in their lives and doing some amazing things, but they feel distant from the Savior, and they want to have a greater intimacy with the Lord. And so the thing that needs fixing, the thing that needs fixing is why not both? ¿Por qué no los dos? We don't have to choose one or the other, right? We don't just need grace or works. We need grace and works. We don't just need love or holiness. We need love and holiness. We don't just need the face of God or the hand of God. We need the face of God and the hand of God. We don't have to just pick one or the other. God is a God of balance. I know I talk about that a lot. You probably got tired of me hearing about it from me. I won't bore you with the whole Ecclesiastes chapter 3, but there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heaven. Right? All of God's word is balanced by all of God's word. God's word isn't your favorite verse in the Bible, and it isn't your favorite chapter in the Bible, and it isn't your favorite theological viewpoint in the Bible. God's word is all of it, from Genesis to Revelations. So I feel like this idea of seeking the face of God, which is a good and glorious teaching, has also, though, created some negative feelings in our congregations when it comes to seeking the hand of God. There shouldn't be a negative stigmatism in the church about seeking God's hand, because it doesn't have to be one or the other, right? It can be both. I have been the super duper spiritual pastor before, where I just get so fixated and tell people, you need to stop seeking God's hand and you need to start seeking God's face. And I mean, it's a good thing to seek God's face, but there are times in our lives when we need a miracle from God. And you'll find when you read the word of God that people do both of those things, right? That's what this prayer of Jabez, one of the most famous prayers in the Bible, is he's seeking the hand of God. Jabez cried out to the God of Israel, "Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Let your hand be with me. Keep me from harm, so that I may be free from pain." And God granted his request. There are a lot of people in our congregation right now that need the hand of God to touch their lives. There are a lot of families in our congregation that are facing major things going on in their families. There are people that desperately need a miracle from God, who need the hand of God to do for them what the hand of God did for Jabez, to bless them, to keep them from harm, to keep them free from pain. And I don't want people that need the hand of God on their lives to feel guilty or ashamed or embarrassed. If you need the hand of God in your life, don't feel guilty about seeking his hands. Instead, do both, right? Seek his face, seek his hands. And if you need his hand on your life, then be bold enough to pray like Jabez prayed, "Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory. Let your hand be on my life." God granted his request. God is going to grant our requests when we get bold enough to come to him and ask him and pray to him about this thing. But we have to be making a request to get the request granted, right? James chapter 4 and verse 2, "You have not because you ask not." Jesus loved to touch people's lives. That's what you read about him doing all through Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and even in Acts through the lives of the apostles. It's what he wants to do now through us and in us. That's what Jesus did. He took his hands and he put them on people, and those people's lives were changed forever. Luke chapter 5, while Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground, and the leprous man begged Jesus, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." And Jesus reached out his hand, and he touched the man, and he said, "I am willing, be clean." And immediately the leprosy left him. Jesus didn't have to, and I know this, we talk about this a lot, Jesus didn't have to touch that leprous man, right? He could have just said from the block away, "Hey, I know what's going on in your life. You don't have to get any closer to me. You are healed. Go on and go your way." Jesus didn't do that to him, and that's not what Jesus wants to do to us. Jesus wanted to touch that man and to let him know that he loved him. Jesus wants to touch us, right? Our God has hands, and Jesus wants to touch your life today, during our altar time, during the service, at the altar, in your seat, wherever it may be. If you came to the house of God needing the hand of God to touch your life, I believe that Jesus is going to minister to you this morning. Let's pray together about this idea and talk about it. Lord, thank you that we can be in this house. Lord, I pray that you would prepare our hearts and minds and our spirits to receive. There are people that desperately need the hand of God to touch their life, and I pray that this day would be their day, that Jesus would, you would touch them, and that they would leave this place changed for all of eternity. Lord, may we receive your word, and may you do for all of us what I can't do in my preaching. Please do that by your Holy Spirit. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so there are a lot of points this morning, so they're going to be shorter, so don't worry if you're worried. You're like, "Oh my gosh, he has twice as many points as usual. I hope it's not twice as long." It's not. So there is power in his hands. There is a reason that Jabez cried out, "Let your hand be with me," because God's power flows from God's hands, and we need the power of God at work in our lives. Job chapter 12, it says, "In his hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind." Psalms 102, "In the beginning you laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands." Exodus 15, "Your right hand, O Lord, was majestic in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shattered the enemy." Right? So the hand of God represents the power of God. Habakkuk chapter 3, "His splendor was like the sunrise, rays flashed from his hand where his power was hidden." Every creature and all of mankind is sustained by the power of his hand. The mountains, the seas, the plains are sustained by the power of his hand. The entire earth and all of the heavens are sustained by the power of his hand. We needed the power of God to do anything, and we need the power of God to do everything. Romans chapter 8, I'm just going to talk about a little thing that Paul says here. Romans chapter 8, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." Facing death all day long and more than conquerors. So I'll just admit something to you. I like to admit things to people. I think I'm going to start an AA for the church. I like to confess things so much. I got two late notices from the DMV this last week, and I almost just threw in the towel. Like, I'm done with this. Like, I don't know. We're trying to manage 5 car registrations in our family. I don't know when one's coming, when one's going. It's like, did we pay this one? I don't know. I guess I should figure out a system. But it was so depressing to get late notices where you're paying the government. California, that's already overcharging you for your registration, and now they're tacking on another couple hundred dollars for each one. And I'm thinking about, here I am, just I'm crying before the Lord. Oh, like I just want to give up. And then here's Paul, who's talking about, I face death all day long, and I feel like I'm more than a conqueror. So I'm thinking, whatever it is that Paul had, I need some of that in my life. Right? I want to be able to face more than a couple of late notices from the Department of Motor Vehicles and want to give up on everything. I need some strength and some power in my life. Paul was able to face death, and I can't even face my air conditioning bill, right? Paul wrote about a power that comes from the hand of God that enables us to face the most extreme difficulties and still conquer over them. And that is the power that I need so that I can face everything that life throws at me, and I can still keep on serving Jesus with all of my heart for all of my life. That's what I want. There's power in the hand of God. There are blessings in his hands. Jabez prayed, oh, that you would bless me. And the Lord didn't say, I rebuke you, Jabez. Right? He's like, how dare you, Jabez, come to prayer and you just ask me to bless you. It says he prayed that the Lord would bless him, and the Lord granted his request. We shouldn't be ashamed or embarrassed to pray boldly in his throne room, Lord, bless me. In Genesis chapter 49, I just want you to hear this passage about the blessing of the Lord. Because of the hand of the Almighty One of Jacob, because of the shepherd of the rock of Israel, because of your father's God who helps you, because of the Almighty who blesses you with blessings of the heavens above, blessings of the deep that lies below, blessings of the breast and womb, your father's blessings are greater than the blessings of the ancient mountains, than the bounty of the age-old hills. Let all of these blessings rest on the head of my people, on the brow of the prince among his brothers. That's a lot of blessing, and where did all those blessings come from? The hand of the Almighty One. Don't let anyone shame you out of your blessing. Right? We need the blessing of God on our lives. The blessing of the Lord includes, but is not limited to, salvation, deliverance, provision, presence, power, anointing, healing, signs, wonders, miracles, renewal, revival, reformation, transformation, all of those, and much, much more than I could list here. And those are all good things, and we need those things to be a part of our lives. We need to pray for the hand of God to be on our lives, because the Bible says that the hand of God invites the blessing of God, and we need his blessing. There is strength in his hands, and I know that we need this one, or I do at least. I need strength. So David prays this prayer before he entrusts the building of the temple to Solomon. I want to read it to you. It's 1 Chronicles chapter 29. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, praise be to you, O Lord God, our Father of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt it and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that you should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand. Everything comes from God. including the strength that we have to live our lives every single day. If we are going to finish the course that the Lord has set out for us, it is going to take more than all of the strength that we have. In His hands, our strength and power to exalt it and give strength to all, every single one of us in this room. He has the strength that we need to finish the course that we're on to do His will. Let's pray that the hand of God be on our lives, because I need His strength to finish doing His will and to bring His name glory on Him. There are answers in His hands. So David's prayer and now Solomon's prayer. 2 Chronicles chapter 6. Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in front of the whole assembly of Israel and spread out his hands. He said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven or on earth. You keep your covenant of love with your servants who continue wholeheartedly in your way. You have kept your promise to your servant David, my father. With your mouth you promised, and with your hand you have fulfilled it as it is today. So we want to see the promises of God come alive in our lives. And of course, we thank God for everything that we have already seen. But I know, and you know, that there is so much more than what we have already seen and what we're seeing right now in the church in America. Solomon said, with his hand, with his mouth, the Lord has made promises. The Apostle Paul said it this way. He said, the answer to all of the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. And yet I have unsaved loved ones that still need saving. I know Christians living in bondage that need to be set free. I know sick people that have served God faithfully for all of their lives who still needed to be healed. So what's going on with that? Well, it is with his mouth that he has promised, but it is with his hand that he fulfills his promises. And when is the last time that I cried out to God earnestly, or that you cried out to God like Jabez cried out to God and said, oh, that your hand would be on my life? The church needs to get back to boldly praying that prayer, coming in to the throne room of heaven and saying, Father, let your hand be on my life. Don't stop seeking the face of God, but don't be ashamed to ask for the hand of God to bring you the answers that you so desperately need and are waiting for. With his hands, he gives us unity. 2 Chronicles chapter 30, Hezekiah recommits the people of God to the word of God, and they remove all of the things that are defiling the temple, and they return to temple worship, and they return to the Passover, and at the king's command, the couriers went out throughout Israel and Judah with letters from the king and from his officials, which read, people of Israel, return to the Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, that he may return to you who are left. Also in Judah, the hand of God was on the people of God to give them unity of mind to carry out what the king and his officials had ordered, following the word of the Lord. The hand of God brings unity to the church. And when there is unity in the church, great things happen in the church. You probably remember a little revival that started in Acts chapter 2. Right? The day of Pentecost was fully come. They were all in one place and they were all in one accord. Right? One spirit, one mind, in one place. And when that happened in the church, the Holy Spirit was poured out. And the greatest move of God in the history of the church took place. Because the hand of God brought the Spirit of God and unified the people of God. But where there is division, nothing happens where there's division, right? You remember what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined. Every city or household divided against itself will not stand. We have to pray for the hand of God to come to the church in Ivanhoe and in Tulare County and to our nation, because his hand brings unity, and that unity in the church releases the blessing, and the Holy Spirit comes and moves. The hand of God brings salvation. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, the story of Jehoshaphat facing these overwhelming odds of this enemy army coming. He hears the great numbers of this army, and he is distraught because Israel doesn't have an army able to face them. They are facing just imminent destruction unless God intervenes. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat that a vast army is coming against you from Edom. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all of Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in the front of the new courtyard and said, O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all of the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. We will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name, and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us, and you will save us. No one can withstand the hand of the God that we serve. He will hear us, and he will save us. Because of the hand of God on our lives, we don't have to be afraid anymore. The gods of this world, all of their hands have been cut off by the one true God, and they have no power over us as his children. He has saved us, and he will continue to save us. I was just thinking about this as I was going over my notes. I go over them a couple of times before I preach on Sunday, and I was got to this part, and I just thought, he didn't save me when I was 19 years old and grab me by his hand and hold on to my life to let go of me now when I'm 51 years old, right? He didn't grab me then and save me to just let go of me now and to let me perish. He saved me then. He saved me every day since then, even though sometimes I didn't even know it, right? I wasn't even aware of it. I didn't even realize until maybe the last 10 years. He didn't just save me when I was 19. He saved me every single day of my life since then. I wouldn't be here today unless he'd been saving me every minute of every day of every week of every year. So he hasn't saved me to just let me fail or to let me perish. And the same is true for you. God hasn't grabbed a hold of your life just to let go of you now and let something in your life destroy you. He saved you, and he's going to continue to save you. So there's this weird story in 1 Samuel chapter 5. And I just want to talk about some verses in there to make a point. It's the Ark of God has been taken from Israel, and the Philistines have captured it and have now taken it to one of their main cities, and they've taken the Ark of God into their house of worship where their statue of Dagon is, and this is what happens. The Philistines captured the Ark of God. They took it from Ebenezer to Ashdod. Then they carried the Ark into Dagon's temple, and they set it beside their pagan god and his image, Dagon. When the people of Ashdod arose early the next day, there was their pagan god, Dagon, fallen on his face on the ground before the Ark of the Lord. And they thought to themselves, well, that's crazy. What a crazy coincidence that is, right? That we brought in the Ark of the Lord, and now our pagan god, his image is fallen on the ground in front. Let's stand him up again. We need to stand our God up. He needs our help. So they grab the ropes, and they grab the pulleys, and they fix them to their god, and then they stand their god up, and they, whew. They put him back in his place. The following morning when they rose, there was their pagan statue of their god, Dagon, fallen on his face on the ground before the Ark of the Lord. This time, his head and his hands had been broken off and were lying on the threshold, and only his body remained. And this time, they thought, maybe this isn't a coincidence. The hands of the gods of this world have been cut off by Jesus. It is our Lord Jesus Christ who rose from the dead and conquered over death, hell, and the grave, and he reigns from the throne of heaven. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. But the good news in this is that all of those principalities and powers that conspire against us, they don't have hands or a head. They've been cut off. There's only one God that has an unstoppable hand that can save us from any situation we're facing, and that is the God that we serve, right? The unstoppable hand of God. Isaiah chapter 14. For the Lord Almighty has purposed, and who can thwart him? His hand is stretched out, and who can turn it back? Psalms chapter 44. It was not by their sword that they won the land, nor did their arm bring them victory. It was your right hand, your arm, and the light of your face, for you love your people, Lord. Our Savior has hands, and he wants to touch you this morning because he loves you. It was your right hand, your arm, the light of your face, because you love them. No one is going to be able to stop his hands from empowering, blessing, strengthening, answering, unifying, saving. We are going to turn on some worship music and spend a little time at the altar.